The vast majority of plaque, heart attack, and stroke is not really caused by full-blown diabetes. It's caused by prediabetes, and I strongly suspect that with you. Getting into your late 50s, your 60s, starting to get plaque, the most common story in the world in this space. And a couple of things to think about. Everybody says, if I've had it once, I've had it over 100 times. People come to me and say, Doc, my blood sugars are great. My doc checks it every year and I check up on him. John Lorscheider, if you go back and review his video that he made for our channel, he knew that. He's like you. He knew this space very, very well. And he said, but Doc, I know you're a nut about this. So, okay, I'll go ahead and get tested. We did a craft insulin survey on him and his blood glucose went up to 291. So from that perspective, he actually had full-blown diabetes. Like me, like probably yourself, like many other people, his fasting blood glucose was 90. Like many of us, he had a nice low hemoglobin A1C. So why would hemoglobin A1C be low if you have this problem? Well, a couple of reasons. If you look this up with the American Association of Clinical Endocrinologists or the American College of Endocrinologists, they both say the same thing. They say, don't use A1C to make this diagnosis or to rule it out, because it's deceptive in a host of areas, multiple types of anemia, multiple types of genetics and ethnicities, multiple types of genetic variations in hemoglobin, multiple types of variations in terms of red blood cell count and life. So the bottom line is it's easy. Patients don't have to take a couple of hours to get the test done. So that's what docs do, but it's not adequate. And clearly, what's actually used more often is just a fasting glucose. Fasting glucose is not adequate either. Until you've had a full-blown OGTT, oral glucose tolerance test, in other words, challenged that glucose level and measured both glucose and insulin after that challenge, you really don't know. So we can help you do that if you just want to do it yourself. There are clearly plenty of ways to do it yourself and you can find it on our channel. Either way you go, I would strongly advise that you get a full-blown challenge and get both glucose numbers and insulin numbers. The reason I say and insulin numbers is something else that people don't understand. Even if they go to the extent, very few people understand that you really have to challenge your glucose metabolism to understand it. So those people go ahead, they get to the point of doing the OGTT. Quite often, sometimes they'll see not so bad numbers. Here's why insulin is important. I had a patient, female physician, started with me last year. Her glucose post-challenge peaked at 150, which is, you know, it's insulin resistance for sure, but it's not bad. It took her twice the optimum peak for insulin to manage it at that level. The optimum peak for insulin is 50. Insulin had to go up to 100 to keep her blood sugar down as low as 150. So clearly had that problem. Again, never would have seen it from a A1C or fasting glucose. Fast forward another year, she actually had COVID problems and several other issues and has progressed. Her most recent insulin survey, her blood sugar went up, peaked at over 200, it peaked at about 230. So full-blown diabetes at this time. And at least her body's still making insulin. Her insulin peaked at 250. So it took a level of 250 of insulin to keep her blood sugar just as low as 230. Again, significant problems. Two other points, very significant points that she demonstrated was, number one, she's got little to no problems associated with this. She's aware of it. She's keeping the carbs out of her diet. She's managing her lifestyle. And like so many diabetics that I have in my practice, her plaque's not progressing. She doesn't have inflammation. And she's very comfortable that she's safe and protected from her diabetes. The second point to think about with her is that had they watched her fasting glucose, 90, hemoglobin A1C, low fives. Here's my perspective, and I'm fairly safe in that position. You don't do YouTubes without, you know, getting criticized and haters. I get amazingly little for the opinions that I give on diet, and here's why. It's pretty hard to argue with the fact that if you have prediabetes or diabetes, in other words, if you cannot metabolize carbs, you probably shouldn't be eating them. That's been my position from day one. Now, the stuff about carnivore, I've got plenty of folks on carnivore. It's not by my recommendation, but I'm not afraid of carnivore at all. I don't have a huge problem with carnivore. I'm much more concerned about somebody like the patient I just described a minute ago, or somebody like myself, routinely eating pasta. That's far more dangerous than a carnivore diet. As I said before, if you go to the point of getting that OGTT, strongly suggest it. I would also get the insulin values as well. So I'd like to talk with you a minute about the webinar. People don't understand what the webinar is. It's actually a great way to get some access to healthcare that you're just not going to get any other way. You actually get the lab tests yourself at a local lab, a Quest lab near you, for the inflammation panel and the OGTT and the insulin survey. These are things, inflammation and prediabetes, that your doctor just does not know about. And here's the thing. Harvard Health and many others have said, look, sudden death is not always so sudden. The Hollywood picture that it's a bolt out of the blue is not realistic. It's more like real lightning, preceded by clouds, wind, and rain. Stop that metabolic storm before the lightning strikes. And here's where that metabolic storm comes from. It's inflammation, and it has to do usually with prediabetes. So again, we actually get labs, we go over them in the webinar, and then you can start finding out how you can prevent that heart attack others said that you couldn't even predict. We can show you how. Thanks.